So I want to share with you a story that caught me off guard this week because I was reading. I'm just going to read it to you because I don't think I can really tell it to you with justice. I'm not a big fan of just reading stories to you guys, but I want to do this one because I don't think I can give it the same punch. All right, so this author, he writes, and he's describing an experience. He says, "One of the saddest experiences of my childhood happened on my 10th birthday. Invitations to the celebration were mailed days in advance to 8 friends. It would be my best birthday ever," he said. "They all came to my house right after school. We played football and basketball outside until dark. My dad grilled hot dogs and hamburgers while my mother put all the finishing touches on my birthday cake. After we had eaten all the icing and ice cream and most of the cake, it was time for presents. He said, honestly, I can't even recall one of the gifts today, but I do remember the great time I was having with the guys who gave them. He said, since I had no brothers, the best part of the whole event was just hanging out with the other guys. The climax to this grand celebration wasn't a gift from them to me, but was a gift from me to them. He said, nothing was too good for my friends. Cost was immaterial. I was going to pay their way to the most exciting event in our small town, the high school basketball game. He said, I can still see us spilling out of my parents' station wagon with laughter on that cool evening, running up to the gymnasium, standing at the window, paying for 9 25-cent tickets, and surrounded by my friends. It was one of those simple but golden moments in life. But then, the golden moment was shattered. Once in the gym, all my friends scattered, and I never saw them again the rest of the night. So there was no thanks for the fun, the food, or the tickets. Not even a happy birthday, but I'm going to go sit with someone else. Without a word of gratitude or goodbye, they all left and didn't look back. So I spent the rest of my 10th birthday in the bleachers by myself, growing old alone. As I recall, it was a miserable long game. He says, I tell you that story not to gain sympathy for a painful childhood memory, but because it reminds me of the way we often treat God in worship. That's what it got me. I got the tears in my eyes. Though we come to an event where God is the guest of honor, it is possible to give him a routine gift, sing a few customary songs to him, and then totally neglect him while we focus on others and enjoy the performance of those in front of us. Like my 10-year-old friends, we may leave without any twinge of conscience, without any awareness of our insensitivity, convinced we have fulfilled an obligation well. Ouch. That describes many of my own worship experiences. Matthew 4:10, Jesus responding to Satan after he was tempted in the wilderness. It says, Jesus said to him, "Be gone, Satan, for it is written, you shall worship the Lord your God alone, and him shall you serve." So I want to talk about worship. What is it? What exactly is worship? Is it the songs that we sing? Right? You often hear people refer to the songs that are sung in a service as, well, that's the worship time, and now I'm preaching, so that's the preaching time. Well, I would say it's all worship. I would say this, that true worship begins when we begin to see God for who he is, not as we would have him, and we begin to respond accordingly. That's true worship. That can happen here, that can happen while I'm preaching, that can happen while we're singing songs, that can happen when I'm home in my Bible, that can happen when I go through things in life that are hard, that can happen when I go through things in life that are good. Worship can happen anywhere, and it should happen everywhere. It should happen everywhere. The problem is, though, is that sometimes our view of God is far too short-sighted. Right? We want to praise God when things are good. We want to wonder where he is when things are bad. You know, God, how could you have let this happen to me? How could you have let this bad thing happen to me? Yeah. Here's what I want to ask. Do we not owe more to God than that? And so here's my question to you. What are we going to give more? And as we go through this today, I want you guys to ask yourselves that question. And I want you to answer that for yourselves, because I can't answer that question for you. Like, I'm not going to be one of those guys who's going to stand up here and say, oh, you know, your worship to God is indicated by your church community. You know, if only we get more people to volunteer so we can run some programs. No, that's not it. Worship should happen in everything that we do, whether we're in church or out of church. What can you do to give God more? What can I do to give God more? So we've been going through the book of Luke. And, you know, it's been quite a journey so far. I'm not even to the first chapter yet. So we're going through the book of Luke. And I'm calling this sermon series a historical portrait of the God-man. Right, so Luke, who is, and I'm a firm believer that the church has lost sight of Jesus. I think that one of the reasons that we see the church in the state that it's in today is because, as I mentioned for several weeks in a row now, the gospel of Jesus Christ has become common to his people, and that's a very sad thing. And so I felt like God and the Holy Spirit was leading me to preach through the book of Luke so that we might rediscover just who Jesus is and fall in love with him in a deeper, more real way than we have ever experienced him before. That's the purpose of this series. All right, so far, what we've realized is that in the beginning matter, what we saw is we have Luke, and he's writing this introduction to the guy that he's writing this book for, a guy by the name of Theophilus, which literally means lover of God, or he who loves God. We don't know exactly who he was. We don't know if that's his real name. We don't know for sure where he served, but the fact that Luke called him most excellent probably indicates that he was a government official of some kind, and he was probably encountering the gospel and realizing that if what he was hearing was true, then it really didn't matter what it was going to cost him in this life. It was because you can bet that it was going to cost him his position. He was a high-powered government official. It was going to cost him his income. It was going to cost him his livelihood if he decided to follow Jesus. Because at that point in time, Christians were persecuted and killed by Rome. Okay, so that's what's going on here. So what he did is he hired a guy who was a physician. We see that Luke, though not named in this gospel, we see that this is in the second volume of his work, which is the book of Acts. You know, we see that all of a sudden we go from talking in third person to first person. We did this, we did that. And so all of a sudden the author who wrote Luke, and halfway through Acts, so he becomes part of the story. He's there. You know, so what we think is that he is the beloved physician who Paul refers to in his letters. We believe that Luke was a very educated man. We think that he was also a historian, and that he was hired by this guy to go and determine whether or not the things that he heard of Jesus were true. Because he wasn't just going to go jump on board something and follow it blindly without knowing it's true. And to that I say amen. I don't think any of us should just go follow something blindly, you know, just because we think it sounds good. I think that before we do that, it would be wise to determine whether or not it was true. So we think that that is what brought forth the Gospel of Luke in the book of Acts. So far, like, looking past that, we see as Luke begins his story of Jesus, right? In the first few verses, what we see is one of the main characters is Gabriel, a messenger angel sent from God to announce the fulfilling of major messianic prophecies, right? The Messiah is coming. John the Baptist would come. He would be the fulfillment of what's known as foretold to be the second coming of Elijah. This guy would be born. The spirit of Elijah the prophet would be upon him, and he would announce the coming of the Messiah. And this, after the Jews had gone 400 years without hearing anything from God regarding prophecy, they heard nothing, and they were just left in the dark under Roman oppression, under Roman rule. Looking back at a history that was far more glorified than they were the powerhouse. And so what they were hoping for was that eventually the Messiah would come and break the chains of Rome, and that they would again be the most powerful government in the area. That's not what happened. But the Messiah did come. All right, and so what we find is we see this transaction take place between Gabriel and Zechariah in the temple as he's worshiping, lighting incense. And then we see Gabriel appear to Mary out in the middle of nowhere, this young, very, very, very young girl. She was very young, and you know, and I know that I was told last week that it might bother somebody to know that she was probably between 12 and 14 years old, and that's harsh to us because it steps on our toes, and I can't think of my daughter getting married and betrothed then. But back then, like, that was a cultural thing, and that was normal. Like, her betrothal lasted for a year and a half. Her girl would practically be married, but she wouldn't sleep with her husband. She'd stay at home with her parents. Then she would eventually get married, probably around the age of 14, and then she would start her life having children, and that's what Mary's life was supposed to look like. Right? So all of a sudden, here's Mary, this young girl, she's betrothed, and Gabriel shows up to her and says, "You are going to give birth to the Messiah. You're going to give birth to the Messiah." And she asked a legitimate question. She's like, how in the world is that supposed to happen? I'm a virgin. How is that supposed to happen? And so he tells her, he says, the Holy Spirit's going to come upon you. He said, you are going to give birth to who's going to be known as the Son of God. And automatically she knew. She's like, okay, this is going to happen. And so she didn't question. She didn't walk away. And here's the thing. In that moment, her entire life of what she thought was going to happen was going to be turned upside down. Because here's what that was going to look like for her. We see this tension played out in the book here in the next chapter or so, is that her husband is going to be looking at her like, you Right? So she's pregnant. You cheated on me. The rest of their community is going to be looking at her the same way. And she was going to raise the Messiah. She's going to watch this young boy live a sinless life, be nailed to a cross, and she was going to get a front row seat. She was going to get to see him. Okay? So she's going to have to grow up, raise this son in a community where basically he's going to be known as a child who was born out of an adulterous relationship. And she was going to be seen as an adulteress, and her husband was going to be looked at like a chump because he did not divorce her and possibly kill her. Okay? So, though he had this blessing on God that was going to change the rest of the world, that was going to be the greatest gift to the world that mankind has ever seen, this gift turned her entire life upside down. And what anybody with a worldly perspective would say is not for the better, but for the worse. For the worse. I wouldn't wish the pain that she felt on anybody. And yet, what did she do? She just walked away. She said, "Let it be to me as you say." And so that's where our story today picks up. Right? So then what ends up happening is actually at this point in time, she hears, because the angel tells her, and not only that, your cousin, who is old of age, she's been declared to be barren, she's pregnant too. She's going to give birth to a son. So she immediately, it says, that she goes and wants to be with Mary. You know, so here within these first few verses, what we see is the praise of Mary for her faith in God. Praise of Mary for her faith. Let's look at verse 39. It says, "In those days, Mary arose and went with haste into the hill country to a town of Judah. And Gabriel told Mary that she would give birth to the Messiah. He also mentioned that her cousin was pregnant, and now she was 6 months along, is what the text tells us." Right? Now, we know that there was no cute birth announcements, there was no social media, there was no cell phones, that there wasn't any cute little picture with a sonogram in there with the little booties telling whether it's going to be a boy or a girl. There's nothing like that. The angel told her that she was going to be pregnant. And so she goes immediately, right, to a town that's probably 100 miles south of where she was at. And most scholars believe it was a 4 or 5 day journey. She most likely would have been traveling on foot because she's poor. And so she took off because she wanted to go and be in community with her cousin, who was also experiencing a miraculous pregnancy, a miraculous act of God. That 400 years of silence from God was being broken by this announcement. And she wanted to go be with her cousin so they could both go through this together. Right? Both of these were clear testimonies to God's power and his ability to break into the broken world. Verses 40 and 41. And then she entered the house of Zechariah and greeted Elizabeth. And when Elizabeth heard the greeting of Mary, the baby leaped in her womb. And Elizabeth was filled with the Holy Spirit. In these verses, we see this dramatic connection, these two cousins who are going through this amazing work of God. And they're celebrating the fulfillment of these prophecies, and they're coming together. And here's the thing. Notice what happens here. Is Mary, so who all's in the story at this point in time? Is it two people? I'd say it's four. There's four people in the story, right? So you have Mary, you have Elizabeth. Elizabeth is 6 months pregnant with John the Baptist. And Mary is now pregnant with Jesus. So the minute Mary approaches and enters the house, what happens? The baby, this prophet that's inside of the womb of Elizabeth, jumps, right? And we find out that she jumps for joy. It says that the baby leapt in her womb. And so basically what's happening is this prophet inside this woman's belly is jumping, leading the mom into worship, saying, "Hey, your Savior is here. Your Savior's here. Go see him." And she goes on, and this is exactly what she says, too. She goes on, she says, "For behold," she said, "For behold, when the sound of the greeting came to my ears," Elizabeth said, "the baby in my womb leaped for joy." So not only is this baby inside of a woman leaping and leading the mom into worship, okay, in response to Jesus coming, but now we're ascribing emotions such as joy to this baby that's inside the womb. Okay, so now, I would not be doing my job as a pastor and as someone who loves to study scripture if I didn't point out two ginormous elephants in the room that clash headfirst with our culture right now. Clash headfirst with American westernized culture. Okay, and the first one is this, the two controversial pregnancies. Okay, in our day and age, what would happen if a woman who was, a lot of people want to say she was in her 80s. I don't know, I wasn't there, there's not enough research to say, well, she was probably this old. But she was old enough to be declared barren. What happens when an older woman gets pregnant? It becomes very, very, very detrimental to the health of the woman. And so now, what would be the advice that most doctors would give an elderly woman in our day and age who ended up getting pregnant? Terminate the pregnancy. Terminate the pregnancy. Okay? Now, that's the first controversial pregnancy. The second one, you have a girl very young, between the ages of 12 and 14. She's pregnant. Right? Now she's sitting there saying, I'm pregnant by the power of the Holy Spirit. Yeah, okay. Pregnant by the power of the Holy Spirit. Whatever got you pregnant, terminate the pregnancy. That's going to be the advice given by any doctor in our age in any one of these two pregnancies. What do they do instead? That option isn't even brought up. And for those of you who think that it wasn't an option back then, it was just as common and as accepted in first century Rome among all classes of people as it is today in ours. Okay? So it wasn't like, oh, they didn't have that back then. And that's not true. Listen to this. Listen to how they responded. Right? Verses 42 and 43. Elizabeth says, she exclaimed with a loud cry, wow, I'm sad that you're pregnant so young. I really wish this didn't happen to you. I think you should go see Planned Parenthood and take care of that. No, that's not what she said, is it? What does it say? Verse 42 and 43. And she exclaimed with a loud cry, blessed are you among women, and blessed is the fruit of your womb. That's what she said. Culture clash. Culture clash. Right? The passage has implications that are absolutely contrary to our day and age right now. And we need to talk about that. Listen to this. These are just things from a paper written by a woman named Margaret Sanger back in 1934. The paper, you can find it, it's filed in the Library of Congress. And I'm just going to read a few pieces of it, and there are just various articles. The name of it is America Needs a Code for Babies. Okay, America Needs a Code for Babies. A Plea for Equal Distribution of Births by Margaret Sanger. And I'm going to read a few of these articles. The first article says this: the purpose of the American Baby Code shall be to provide for a better distribution of babies, to assist couples who wish to prevent overproduction of offspring, and thus to reduce the burdens of charity and taxation for public relief, and to protect society against the propagation and increase of the unfit. Article 2. Birth control clinics shall be permitted to function as services of city, county, and state health departments, or under the support of charity, or as a nonprofit, self-sustaining agency subject to inspection and control by public authorities. Article 3. A marriage license shall in itself give husband and wife only the right to a common household and not the right to parenthood. Article 4. No woman shall have the legal right to bear a child, and no man shall have the right to become a father without a permit for parenthood. Article 5. Permits for parenthood shall be issued upon application by city, county, or state authorities to married couples, providing they are financially able to support the expected child, have the qualifications needed for proper rearing of the child, have no transmissible diseases, and on the woman's part, no medical indication that maternity is likely to result in death or permanent injury to health. Article 6. No permit for parenthood shall be valid for more than one birth. Now, obviously, we're not there yet. This is her, like, vision casting for the organization that she's in the process of birthing. You know what it is? Like, if you're going to start a business or something, or you want to plant a church, you vision cast. You sit down and say, 10 years, 20 years, 30 years, where do I want to be? Where do I want to see this thing go? You know, you dream big, and that's her dreaming big. Okay? And now, here's what I want to say to this. Is that sounds horrendous to us, right? Because we believe in God. We believe that God is the author of life. We believe that he created the world and that he ordains people and their purposes too. But here's the thing, is that if God alone is the sovereign author of life, then abortion in this line of thinking is high treason against the highest authority in existence. Okay? So if God dictates purposes of people's lives, and that's a real thing, and so we see the God of the Bible, and he's real, then this kind of thinking and this thing is high treason against the highest authority in existence. But if the God of the Bible isn't real, this makes perfect sense. If it's only up to us, and we can determine what's best for the world, and really, like, humanism is true, and we get to determine what happens and what doesn't, then this makes perfect sense. That it's logical. You know, we don't want people having too many babies. We want to make sure that we can weed out diseases. We want to make sure that, you know, that's not what God says we get to do. That's not what God, that's not what God says we get to do. That's not our place. We are the recipients of life. He's the author of life. And so here's the thing. What does the Bible say about God and life in general? And we have to ask that question, right? I mean, if I'm going to go where I just did, we need to ask the question, what does the Bible actually say about God and the authority in life? Now, I want to be very clear. The Bible doesn't mention abortion specifically. And a lot of people are like, see? It doesn't mention abortion specifically. But it does tell us clearly how God would view it, okay? Now, a lot of people might sit there and say, well, yeah, you're talking about the second coming of Elijah and Jesus. Of course God is going to have that authority and that kind of thing. But that's just a one-off, isn't it? Like, that's a special occasion. Well, what does it say? Let's find out. Okay? Jeremiah 1:5 lets us know that God knows us before he forms us in the womb of our mom. Okay? Psalm 139:13-16 says that, you know, it actually indicates God's active hand in forming us while we're in the womb. Okay, there's another one. Exodus 21:22-25, God prescribes the death penalty for someone who does something causing death to a baby who is still in the womb, the same as he would to somebody who causes death to somebody outside of the womb. So what does that tell us? That God prescribes the death penalty because he sees what's in the womb as a life that he has a purpose for, that he is foreordained. Right? So this is just like a really thick, laid-on application of this, because here's the thing, is that we live in a culture right now to where people don't know what it looks like to follow God, and we have churches that are just going blatantly apostate all over the place that are trying to ordain things that are clearly against the Word of God, and people are like, oh, well, see, well, Christians can do this, and God's people do that. No. Absolutely not. Absolutely not. For Christians, it isn't just simply about the woman's right to choose, or somebody, you know, to look at it and say, oh, well, this is a good time or not. It's not about that. If it was that simple, yeah, like, people who believe, that's not the case. What it really comes down to is that if mankind is created in the image of God, it means that we don't have the right to extinguish something that God has created. If God has determined the purpose and the plan for a man's life, and he does it before the foundation of the world was laid, like he says, then it's really a matter of the most helpless form of human life created in the image of God. This is important. It's far more important than I can give credit for. And I promise you, I don't wake up on Monday morning or Sunday after the very rare occasion I get to take a nap and think, what can I preach on next week that's going to step on somebody's toes? Okay, I don't like to preach about politics, but when politics goes into what God's Word says, I don't have a choice. I don't have a choice. A quote from an article titled Abortion in the Early Church. It says, abortion was practiced on a regular basis, because I had to ask the question if it was even a thing back then. Abortion was practiced on a regular basis among the poor, slave, merchant, and royal class, to ancient peoples and the Romans, and abortion was abnormal. It didn't matter. It wasn't good or bad. Solely up to you. You get to determine for yourself. That was the culture. Right? And that's where we're going now. It's like that's where we're entering. Listen to this. Both women, however, even though these pregnancies, that these lives that God was putting into them were going to change their life and bring risk to their own lives and just drastically change everything. Listen to what Elizabeth says to Mary in verse 45. She says, and blessed is she who believed that the Lord, or that there would be a fulfillment of what was spoken to her from the Lord. See, there was no rose-colored glasses here. Neither of these women looked at it and said, God's blessing me. That means my life is going to be great from now on. Wasn't that? That now, this promise that God was going to step into a broken world and fix it, that God was going to send a Savior. Blessed is she because she believed what was spoken to her from God. Depending upon how old Elizabeth was, she could have lost her life delivering that baby. And maybe the baby's life too. The risk was very, very, very high. Very high. Mary could have lost her husband and been stoned to death outside of her village. She was most likely seen as an adulteress, okay, throughout her entire life. And we know that she got to watch Jesus die on the cross. She also got to witness his resurrection. That I'm jealous of. I wouldn't want the other experience, though. So what was her response to Elizabeth's assertion? What was her response? She worshipped. She worshiped. And so then this is another thing when it comes to worship. I want to point us to Mary as an example. The same way that I pointed us to Mary as an example last week of what it looks like to really give your heart to God and follow Him no matter what it might cost you. Mary is worthy of an example to follow, worthy of being called an example to follow when it comes to what it looks like to worship God in all circumstances and in all things that life has to throw at you and anything that God might call you to. Mary, again, is a great example to follow. She's an example for all of us. Right, so we enter into what's called the Magnificat. It's Mary's song of praise. And the thing about this is that it's almost all Old Testament quotes and references. Almost the entire thing. Like, I mean, if I were to go through a cross-reference and point out where the next 10 or 11 verses came from, I'd be bouncing all over the Old Testament for the next 30 minutes. Okay, so I'm not going to do that. Just cross-reference it yourself. Look at it. It's all quotes and references from the Old Testament. Let's look at verses 46 and 48. And Mary said, "My soul magnifies the Lord, and my spirit rejoices in God my Savior, for He has looked on the humble estate of His servant." What does it mean, like, when Mary looks at herself and she goes, "My soul magnifies the Lord"? What does it mean to magnify the Lord? When you think of magnification, what does it mean to magnify something? Now, if any of you guys are on Facebook, you may have seen I was looking for a magnifying glass or a microscope. Turns out I had one, but it's kind of big and heavy. I didn't want to carry it around and show you guys up here in the pulpit. But with a magnifying glass or a microscope, what you end up doing is you put something, one thing, under a lens, and that one thing gets so big, and you focus on that one thing, and what happens to everything else? It becomes small and insignificant. Right? So Mary says that my soul magnifies the Lord. She says nothing else matters. My soul magnifies the Lord. This is worship. This is what worship looks like. Because my spirit rejoices in God my Savior. For He has looked on the humble state of His servant. For behold, from now on all generations will call me blessed. For He who is mighty has done great things for me, and holy is His name. Mary recognized that though her life, as she knew it, was pretty much over, and it was only going to get harder and harder, God was showing her favor in the midst of the hardship. And that was happening, and what was going on was way bigger than her. Worship. When you can look at God and you realize that regardless of what you're going through, yes, I just lost a loved one, my spouse just died, my dad just diagnosed with cancer, I was just diagnosed with cancer, guess what? It's bigger than you. God is bigger than you. It's funny, I remember talking to my case right after I got here as a pastor, and he handed me this article by John Piper called "Don't Waste Your Cancer." And the whole premise of it is that cancer was basically given to John Piper, and Mike would say the same thing, that cancer was given to him as a gift from God. How in the world could cancer possibly be a gift from God? How? Because all of a sudden you realize that there's a whole lot of things in your life that you place value on that really aren't worth much. All of a sudden you realize that God is going to be your heartbeat, He's going to be your strength, He's going to be your sustainer through all of it. And then when you're sitting there looking at it, you're like, I don't know what's going to happen when I go from here. And you start to look at your wife and your kids and everything else around you, you realize that God's going to be their sustainer too. God is really, really, really big. And everything else is really, really, really small. Your soul begins to magnify the Lord. Worship. Worship. Then in verse 50, she goes on, she says, and his mercy is for those who fear Him from generation to generation. Right now, at the time, what happened is, so Judah was ruled by Herod the Great. We talked about him a little bit a few sermons back. This guy, he was blatantly evil, and what he slowly did over the 30 years of his reign was basically drop Hellenism into the Jewish culture. And what that meant was basically he was turning the Jews to where they looked just like the Romans. Right, their culture and beliefs and everything else. All right, so Mary was seen, you can see in Scripture, as basically one of the faithful few who God has sustained, who followed God even in the midst of all this. And she goes on, she says, His mercy. She calls this mercy. This gift of this child that was going to uproot her life and turn it upside down, she calls it mercy. So God is showing her mercy. And His mercy that she's now seeing is for those who fear Him from generation to generation. We serve a loving, gracious, and merciful God. But we also serve a God who is just. We serve a God who is just. He's all of those things. You don't get love and grace and mercy without justice. Okay? Now what he's saying here is that if God's mercy is for those who fear him from generation to generation, what that means is that there's also going to come a day when those who don't fear God are no longer going to be shown mercy. There's going to be judgment at some point in time. So she goes on and she praises him for that. Like, this is part of her worship. She says, his mercy is for those who fear him from generation to generation. And then he goes on in verse 51 to 53, she says, he has shown strength with his arm. He has scattered the proud in the thoughts of their hearts. He has brought down the mighty from their thrones and exalted those of humble estate. He has filled the hungry with good things, and the rich he has sent away empty. This is what I like to call God math. Hey, God math. Right, you think, if I can go out and I can get everything for myself, and the better people think of me, and the more I can build myself up, the stronger I can get, the more wealthy I can get, the better a reputation I can get. Well, God, you know, the worldly math is the better off you'll be. God math is the lower he's going to bring you. The more he's going to humble you. Luke 14:11, Jesus writes, for everyone who exalts himself will be humbled. And he who humbles himself will be exalted. If you want God to exalt you, humble yourself. Get as low to the ground as you can. Put your preferences on the back burner. Serve the kingdom. Serve Christ. Serve your church. Serve your family. What you want, your preferences don't matter. You serve in the name of Jesus Christ, and you let him exalt you. If you want to be humble by God, serve yourself. Build your own kingdom. Do what you want. Go out and do your own thing, regardless of what anybody else thinks about it or what God says. And he will humble you. Psalm 138:6. For though the Lord is high, it doesn't get any higher than the Lord. There's no higher authority. It says he regards the lowly, but the haughty he knows from afar. Pays little attention to them. He's like, I'm going to crush them. They don't even need to get close to them. They're done. Verse 54 through 55. He has helped his servant Israel in remembrance of his mercy, as he spoke to our fathers, to Abraham, and to his offspring forever. Mary worshiped God at that point in time for what he was doing on a large scale. And what that means sometimes, in order to do that, you don't get to look at your own life and say, wow, how is God blessing me? God is great because of what he's doing right now. You look at it and you look back in the past. You say, look at what God's done in the past. Look at what God's promised to do in the future. His plan is great. His arm is great. His reach is further than mine. And so you can look back and you can see what he's done in the past, and you can praise him for it. You can look at what he promised in the future. You can praise him for it. And that means that everything that's going on around you, you know, is only working towards that end. And you know that if you're in Christ, if you were with God, then you were serving the same God who delivered Israel from Egypt in Exodus. You were serving the same God. The same God is with you, the one who rose Jesus from the dead. The same God is with you, who proved himself faithful over and over and over again throughout history. That God is with you. That's your God if you're in Christ. That means that regardless of what you're going through, you can worship. You've got to seek to have your view of God farsighted. You don't want it to be nearsighted. Step back, look at the big picture. She was worshiping God not because her life was going well, but because what God was doing in her and through her was great. Was the greatest thing that the Bible has ever promised. The birth of Jesus Christ. The God of Abraham, Isaac, and Joseph, the same God who delivered Israel from Egypt, was sending the Messiah. That's your God. That's my God. So I think it's important, right? I mean, just a good application point for Mary is, what happened when Elizabeth looked at Mary and called her blessed? What did Mary do? Right? So she breaks out in worship. What do we see? Like, how did she worship God? Right? This is a great application for what I was just talking about. She worshiped God by remembering who he is in Scripture. That's how you know who God is. Right now, we all have the Holy Spirit. We're all led by God, right, to do specific things in our lives that only God has ordained. But how do you know if you're actually following God? Because the minute that you feel that some spiritual force is leading you to do something that isn't biblical, you know that it's not God. That's not the Holy Spirit. Bible, we'll find out in Luke later on, tells us about demons, about Satan, and everything else. So we need Scripture. So look what she does. This is the only way that Mary was able to determine what was going on, because she has Scripture. And here's the thing, if you look at Mary and her context, she was probably illiterate. And so for her to be able to go back and come up with this song of praise that was almost all Old Testament quotations and references, she knew her Bible. She knew the Word. She had it memorized. She worshipped God. And so that's how she knew who God was. Charles Spurgeon writes this about this passage. He says, notice how Mary quotes Scripture. Her mind seems to have been saturated with the Word of God as though she had learned the books of Scripture through and had them by heart in more senses than one. And isn't it insightful that though the Holy Spirit was speaking by her, he quoted the older Scriptures in preference to uttering new sentences? What honor he put on the Old Testament by so continually quoting it in the New Testament, even as the Lord Jesus also did. Let us, too, prize every part of God's Word. Let us soak in it until we are saturated with scriptural expressions. We cannot find any better ones, for there are none. John 4, 23 through 24, right? This is the merging of, this is a current merging of what I'll just read it. Jesus says, but the hour was coming and is now here when the true worshipers will worship the Father in spirit and truth, for the Father is seeking such people to worship him. God is spirit, and those who worship him must worship in spirit and truth. So by the Holy Spirit, this is exactly what Mary was doing here. Her heart, despite her circumstances, was crying out to God. Her whole heart was she was worshiping in spirit. She was worshiping in truth. The truth of who God is revealed to her in Scripture. And so you have both. You have to bring them both together. Because otherwise, as a former professor of mine told me, he says, too much Holy Spirit, not enough Bible, you blow up. Too much Bible, not enough Holy Spirit, you dry up. Become rigid. We need both. We need both. Her world was crumbling from the world's perspective, yet she was able to worship in spirit and truth. God wants us to give him our whole heart, but he wants us to know him for who he says he is, not who we would have him be. One of the biggest problems, one of the biggest idols in the church today is as we engage a culture that grows increasingly and more and more increasingly against what God would have us do. Right, one of the biggest things that the church does, and they do this in the name of reaching the lost, is they start to step away from Scripture, and they start to determine by culture who God is. And they say, oh, well, God is now must be accepting of these things going on in the culture, so God must now be okay with things that he's declared in both testaments to be wrong. No, that's not it. And so now what you end up doing is you end up creating in your mind and in your heart a God that looks more like you and more like the world than the God of the Bible. And that's what we call an idol, folks, a handmade, self-made God that does nothing for you. There was a time in America where general Christian morals were assumed, right? Divorce was kind of looked down upon. There was a biblical view of marriage. That's not the case anymore. And here's the thing is that I'm going to say praise God in that. Because what it did is that it made Christians in America lazy. Okay, it made Western Christians lazy. We didn't need to read our Bible. Really, I mean, our faith is really just about good morals, living a good, upright life. You know, look at little Johnny. He's got a good job, went to college, and he didn't have sex outside of marriage. Good job, little Johnny. If he doesn't know Jesus, there's only one faith for him outside of that. We don't know God because we put our Bibles to the side. But now, as we're breaking out of that culture, you know, Christians tend to think that we need to let go of the Bible as we go further into this culture. But what I would say is that Christians need to learn how to not just be biblical, but to be extra-biblical. Because there are going to be things that are going to come at you as laws change, as different things become okay that weren't okay 25 years ago. You are going to need to know why you are for it or why you are against it. Because this general idea of what we had at one point in time, this general westernized morality, is going out the window. So you can't just say, oh, good people go to church. Oh, good people get married, you know, don't have sex outside of marriage. Good people aren't alcoholics. You can't do that anymore. You have to look at it and say, what does the Bible say? What is God actually calling you to in this culture? And what you're going to see is that God is calling us to be more like the first century church than we've probably ever been in a very long time here in America. Because they were birthed into a culture that was so anti-biblical, that was so unbiblical, it wasn't even funny. And so now, as Christians in America are going into a culture, we don't know what to do. So we're compromising left and right. We're just like, oh, we're just going to say God ordains this and God ordains that. It's not the case. We need to get back into the Word. We need to seek the power of the Holy Spirit so we can have discernment. We need to get wisdom from God. And we need to learn how to go forward as he would have us. And here's the thing. That's worship. focusing in, zeroing in on God, and letting everything else around you become small. Let God tell you who He is, what He would have you do. That's worship. Focusing in on God and responding to Him as we are.
That's worship.
Let's pray. Gracious God, we thank you so much for your word. I'm humbled by it, God. It's never one of those things, I can't look at this thing and say, I got it. I'm doing really well at this, Lord. I just thank you so much, God, that your word keeps us humble. Your word keeps us closer to you, because we realize the more we dive into it, the more our need for Jesus is. We need you, God. You're not our helper, you're our savior. You're not a lifeguard, God. We're dead at the bottom of the ocean. You're bringing new life into us. We thank you for that, God. So I pray that you continue to break us out of our comfort zone, not let us be comfortable, God, but to follow you and to love you and to praise you and to worship you with our whole hearts based upon who you are, not who you have to be. We ask this in Jesus' name.